personally a special one for me because it's my 10th investor briefing. So the first one was in the results for March 2009, and we've come a long way from March 2009 to now March 2019. And I was chatting with my friend at Cannes just before this, and he reminded me of a mind speak. Actually, that's the only one he invited me, which I attended, which was sometimes, I think, either in December 2008 or January 2009. And we made a number of promises at that time. And so I leave it to those who watch that to see whether we've lived to that that promise. So this particular briefing will begin off with a recap of the last strategy, Centum 3.0. We came to an end. So we had the 2.0, which ran from 2009 to 2014. Then we had 3.0, which ran from 2014 to 2019. And now this year, we just began Centum 4.0, which is going to run from 2019 for the next 5 years. So for Centum 3.0, we had five pillars. The first one was on return, and the goal was to deliver a return that exceeds the market. I think over the last 5 years, NAV has moved from about 22.9 billion to 52 billion. So that represents about a 20% annualized return. We had a focus to be active in six sectors, which we've been. We had a goal to scale up our asset base. When we began in 2014, it was a 28 billion company. Today it's about 72 billion shillings. In 2009, it was 6 billion shillings, so we've come a long way. There was a pill on brand, there was a pill on cost. Cost, our ceiling was 2%. We're now closing at an average of around 1.5%. So generally on track. You can see the asset growth, you can see the net asset value per share growth. We're now at about 79 shillings per share. What has driven this? We've had, we've likely grown the business organically. We've moved from where we started off at 6 billion to 70 billion. I remember when we had the first strategy for the company, we had ambitious goals, and the question was how will we finance these goals. And I asked the question as a naive incoming CEO, am I going to get capital from the shareholders? Many of my colleagues in subsidiaries, whenever we meet for business review, they speak about capital injection by the shareholder. And I was promptly disabused of that notion. There was no capital forthcoming from my shareholders. I then asked, can I raise capital from other shareholders? And then that was also politely declined. And so the options available were organic growth and to work with our lenders to grow the balance sheet of the business. And therefore, that's what we've largely done. And therefore, we've had to make investments, exit, and then recycle those profits back into the business. So over that period, we've actually, the only share increase we've had is on account of bonus shares that have been issued twice. We had two debt fundraisings. Once, the first one matured in 2017, which was redeemed. We issued one 5 years ago in 2015. It's maturing next year in June, and our intention is to redeem it as well from internally generated funds. And of course, we've worked with our lenders, many of whom are here, on various projects. The objective is that by June next year, when we redeem the bond, is that Centum should be debt free at a CICL level. And therefore the share value, the total assets will be equivalent to the net assets. So we'll roughly be around 60 to 70 billion without any debt. We've been spending about 1.8 billion, 1.9 billion in debt service. And the idea is to pay that out at CICL level and have that cash flow available either to boost the dividend income, or given the price where it is today at 33 shillings, I think it's a wonderful investment opportunity for Centum just to buy back the shares. But then you have annuity income in which you can have a share buyback program, which hopefully will see the price then progressively converge to closer to net asset value and reduce the discount that we currently have. In the real estate business, the return has been at 7%. That is Two Rivers, Palmarina, the Pingo. The good thing is that both Vipingo and Palmarina are debt-free because those were funded from Centum. And then we have Two Rivers Development Limited, where we are a 50% shareholder. We have a number of other partners in that particular investment, and then the marketable securities portfolio. We set an agreement on Monday to sell our shares in Almasi and Nairobi Bottlers. That is at a price of 19.5 billion. We are carrying it in this particular balance sheet at around 16 billion. And our cost of acquisition is about 3 billion. These are businesses that, as you're aware, we've been investing for a long time. We began by consolidating the various assets, the various bottlers. We raised our shareholding in Almasi from about 27% to 54%. And I think it's a positive outcome for the business, but also for us as an investor in that business and for the rest of the investors in the business. And we intend to utilize part of this proceeds to retire our entire US dollar denominated debt. It's about $75 million. That will leave about 120 or 12 billion shillings, which will be deployed into the private equity and marketable securities portfolio. That redeployment will save us about 700 million shillings in annual interest costs. We are earning roughly about 400 million shillings in dividend. And that saving includes any additional income we'll realize on the 12 billion over and above the amount that we used to retire the debt.
Our focus now is shifting to more moving towards cash annuity businesses, so being more cash generative from the annuities of the businesses, as opposed to relying on exits. Because for you to get that value growth, you need a very robust economic growth to underlie the growth in earnings. Because the only way you get growth in value is if you're able to achieve a growth in EBITDA or underlying earnings without a huge deployment of additional capital. So if you take an example of Almasi, when we did the merger in 2013, the profit after tax was just slightly over 100 million shillings. Today it's over a billion shillings. So there's been huge growth in the underlying profitability of the business. However, of all our four pillars, the one that has performed the least satisfactorily is the development side of our business. These are the two power projects. They've taken a lot longer than we had expected. And going into Centum 4.0, we are no longer going to be focusing on the development side of the business. So we're going to focus on just three areas: our private equity business, our real estate business, and our marketable securities business. Private equity, this is Fred's business, so he has a varied portfolio. The strategy has been simple: invest in companies, increase the value, you drive value through increasing underlying earnings, so by growing return on capital. So earnings have to grow faster than the rate at which you're deploying capital into those businesses and realize that value through exits. So it's about a cash-to-cash return model, rather than just booking book returns through revaluations.
At a consolidated income statement level, our bottom line is up 48% from 2.8 billion to 4.1 billion. Of that, about a third is the primary private equity asset, primarily the bottlers and the publishing business, which have given a trading profit of 1.1 billion. 5% growth year on year. We have our financial services, primarily the bank, and Nabo Capital, the asset manager. We have a small leasing company called Zohari. The performance there is a 15% decline in the operating loss. Obviously, as CDAN has published its financials in the last three quarters, it previously has been recording a loss which has been coming down quarter on quarter. And I'm happy to say in the last quarter then the business has returned to profitability. So that's a decline in the loss of that segment of the business. Then we have the core investment operations, which then reflects everything else, including real estate. There you can see our investment income is up 71%. Primary driver there is the Gen Africa exit, where our realized gain was 1.2 billion. Any realized gains in real estate from the sales that James has spoken to are booked in that line. But also there, because of the sizable properties that we hold and the activity that has been there in the last 1 year, as James mentioned, we've been selling our land at several multiples to our carrying value today. So there's a significant unrealized gains. It does reflect the activity, especially at VP Pingo and Palmarina, where in the last 12 months we've broken ground on an industrial park, we've broken ground and significantly progressed on about 1,200 residential units. So that is reflected on that line. From a total cost perspective, largely flat at consolidated level, then a PBT of 41%, and as I mentioned, a bottom line of 48% up year on year. That's our consolidated balance sheet. As an investment company, this is not necessarily a key statement that we focus on, because all this does is to simply sum up all the subsidiaries' assets and liabilities. The core focus for us from a balance sheet perspective is the company standalone balance sheet, which reflects our share of the assets of the individual companies. So we'll not focus much on that one. So then this is the company level return statement. As an investment company at this level, the focus again is the total return. The total return would be the actual cash income realized or the cash profit realized, but also importantly to reflect the performance of the investment portfolio. What we call unrealized gains are a significant component of the total return, because what this gives to the investment community or to our stakeholders is a view of the value creation activities that have gone on in the year and what we expect to realize should we sell any of these assets. For example, James has spoken to the exit that we just announced to the market. Any unrealized gains previously would have been booked in that line. Then when you realize that, it goes up to the profit. I will at some point speak briefly to the methodology through which we value our assets and which shows how conservative or otherwise that line item is. So at company level, total investment income largely flat, 3.2 billion compared to 3.5 billion last year. Having sold Gen Africa, whose gain of 1.2 billion is shown there. It then means the dividends that would have been booked previous in the previous financial year would not be reflected in the current financial year. That's why you see that decline on the dividend level. Also, the dividends in the prior year include what you'd call a realized gain at a subsidiary distributed upwards as a dividend. From a portfolio cost perspective, if you've tracked the way our costs have performed in the last 4 or so years, we've deliberately been managing our cost downwards. So not only are they declining as a percentage of total assets, which has been our key metric, but also in absolute value, the recurrent cost has been coming down, and so has been the one-off cost. What we call one-off cost, you know, strictly speaking, if it were not an IFRS application, these are really investments. This is the operating expenses that we would use to drive some of the investments. For example, consultancies, relating to our investment portfolio. But again, that has come down year on year. Therefore, to close with a PBT of 827 million compared to a PBT of a billion at company level. On the total return, flat, relatively flat, 4.7 billion compared to 4.6 billion prior year. On the side, there is a track, as I mentioned, of how operating costs have been coming down as a percentage of assets, which is typically what a PE firm would have measured as. Our benchmark was 2% of total assets. We've managed that well downward, both in absolute value and as a percentage. As James mentioned, looking forward, given now the focus away from a capital appreciation play to a cash annuity income focus, the benchmark then will shift to comparing costs to our cash annuity income. So we closed the year with a total shareholder funds of 52.6 billion, the NAV, translating to an NAV per share of 79.1 shilling.
Again, consistent with the pillars for Center 4.2, so from a return and dividend payout, our focus is around 20% return on invested capital in the coming years, and a progressive increase of the dividend payout by channeling the funds that we were previously using for interest to reward our shareholders. Capital structure and liquidity, again, you can expect that this year we'll reduce the debt. We don't expect to take more at the CICA level. And then as we have a number of other transactions we're still working on, so as those come through, you might see some more announcements coming through shortly, but also we intend to redeem the bond in its entirety. Operating costs, those probably will be around 15% of cash annuity income. That's a ceiling we've set for ourselves internally. Portfolio focus remain very consistent on the three businesses: real estate, private equity. You may see some new investments coming through in the coming period, probably through the fund, and then the marketable securities business. So it's a very simplified business structure. I want to thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your kind attention, to thank all those who've joined us on live stream.